Hello, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, wherever you are from joining us. Welcome to our webinar. My name is Art Gilliland, and I'm the Senior Vice President and General Manager for Symantec's Enterprise Division at Broadcom. Joining me today is Jon Oltsik from, he's our Senior Principal Analyst from ESG. Jon, thanks for being here.
Thanks, Art. Good to see you.
Good to see you. We are here to talk about what's next for cybersecurity and Symantec. Obviously, there's a lot going on in the world, and so we're gonna try a little experiment here as everybody gets used to and changes with all of the things that are going on in COVID. We're gonna try an experiment, and we're gonna interview each other and share some of the thoughts and learnings that we've gathered. So we're gonna be discussing sort of three main topics for the day. One is just an update on Symantec and what's been going on since the acquisition by Broadcom. The other is changes in the cybersecurity landscape, including those due to the pandemic. So obviously there's lots of changes that always happens in cybersecurity, and John's an expert in the space and does a ton of research. And obviously we do a lot of research. But we also want to talk a little bit about if there are changes based on the pandemic, sort of what we're seeing there. And then we'll talk a little bit about what we think of is coming in the future and our estimations and guesses on what we think is coming just based on our experience and some of the things that we see. So hopefully that is going to be an interesting and valuable discussion for you all. And we look forward to having you along on this experiment. Before we get into the discussion, let me cover a few things just to help orient everyone to the webinar platform we have here. If you wanna ask a question, please feel free to click on Ask a Question button at the bottom left of your screen. We will answer these questions as we go through and go along in the session. So hopefully that will be useful, and we'll try to monitor that and bring those questions into the conversation. So try to include you as much as we can. Under the attachments tab, you'll find a bunch of collateral and links to information that we have created and posted for you. So if there are things you want to understand more, you want to dig down deeper into pieces of what we've discussed, there'll be slides from today's session and maybe some other content that we can post as we go. And then at the end of the webinar, please take some time to give us feedback. Like I said, we've been experimenting and trying to learn as much as we can through the process of interacting with you and interacting with our customers through this new medium. And so getting your feedback, understanding what you liked and didn't like about the session would be super great. And then we'll try to improve as we go forward in future sessions. So finally, this webinar is being recorded, so we will be able to share the content and you can share it with your peers and other folks that you think might find it useful. And so hopefully you find it useful and you want to share it. And so there'll be a link to the session, and you can help other people find it and send it along if that's good. So with that, let's get started. Jon, you're our guest. So I'm going to let you ask the first question. I'll kick it over to you.
All right, Art, and no rest for the weary. I'm going to put you on the spot right away.
Awesome. I like it.
So it's been months since the acquisition of Symantec by Broadcom.
Yep.
I'm hearing rumors in the market. I'm talking to customers. But tell me from your perspective, how's it going for the company? How's it going for customers? And yep. Kind of interestingly, what have you learned? What have you learned personally during that transition?
Yeah, I would say it's been a journey, no question. I think some of it has been incredibly positive. And the transition has been good, obviously, for the business and some of the execution that we're doing. But it's also been painful, no question. The transition has been complicated. We've moved a lot of our infrastructure over to Broadcom. And so that transition has been rocky in some cases. Some cases it was very smooth, in some cases it was incredibly painful. I think what I would say that I have really admired and really think about in terms of the transition is Broadcom's focus on execution and speed. I think what I've learned away from it is, yes, there is transitional pain and it can be rocky, but now we're done. if you look at the transition from Symantec, you know, Symantec had three ERP systems, all of these acquisitions that we've made and brought in, and you make compromises as you do that integration, it ends up creating a level of complexity in the organization that made us kind of hard to do business with. Broadcom's transition has been way more complicated, I think, than some of the acquisitions that we made while we were at Symantec. But now we're on one system, we're on one infrastructure, we have a single process for execution. And so while the pathway to get here was a little more bumpy, I think now it will be way easier to do business with the company and a lot easier to get things done. And that simplicity in process, that simplicity is going to, I think, make the customer service part of our business stronger and better. I think it'll focus our teams more on just the delivery of the technology and the product versus fighting the internal infrastructure that we often had to do at Symantec. And it'll let us be a little more flexible and creative as we go through. And so that is absolutely part of it. And so while the transition was complicated, and I guess the best way to sum it up is move fast, break stuff, and then fix the broken stuff as you go, I think is probably the way that I would think about it. And so at a very high level, I think that's where we are. Where we've settled now, though, is we're now transitioned onto other systems. We're transacting all of our business and all of our revenue on Broadcom. All of our infrastructure is separated now from the Norton company. And so now we're just back to focusing on the execution that we have to do. And that's our roadmap. We still are focused very, very much and believe very strongly in this idea of integrated cyber defense. And so that is the belief that if you take all of these tools that companies buy, all of these technologies, ours included, as well as others, the biggest job for most of our security customers is to make these things work together effectively so they can create a platform for protecting themselves, a cyber defense environment. And so Broadcom's now, Symantec, part of Broadcom's strategy has been for the last couple of years and will remain as we go forward, a focus on trying to drive that integration across our tool sets. And Symantec wants to become the baseline for that cyber defense environment. And at Symantec, we have very strong endpoint security technology. So the connection point where your users interact with your services, we have very strong web and email and sort of that network connection. So not only where your customers are or where your employees are interacting, but also the tubes and network connections where that transaction goes over. We have a very strong investment in the protection of information. So understanding what information is valuable and how do you protect it and set policies on it. And then now with the inclusion of the identity assets from CA, we have the ability to understand who you are and where you are. And so a lot of the strategic focus is to not only try to continue to be great in those categories and drive innovation in those categories, but also drive the integration across those categories. And we believe if we do that effectively, not only are we going to improve the security responsiveness and speed at which customers can respond, but we're also going to significantly lower the cost of operating this environment. And so that's a big part of how we see the future and where we're going to go. So that was a kind of long-winded way. So rocky, but I think effective way to get there. And I hope that our customer experiences is improving. I know that there have been challenges on licensing and support, and there's been a lot of transitions. But I think we're coming through the tail end of that. And I would hope in the next month or so, we'll clean up even more of that stuff. And as we go, we'll do that. And then a doubling down or a refocus on that integrated cyber defense and really driving the stability and quality of that experience for our customers, what we see there. So, all right, now it's my turn to ask you a question.
Sure.
So obviously the threat landscape continues to be more complex and the adversary is always evolving. So that's something that hasn't changed probably for the last two decades, at least that I've been in the security space. But there's particularly now with this new event, the pandemic. Do you think there's anything that's fundamentally changed? Are you hearing anything from your customers and your clients that makes you think that there might be something that's fundamentally changed? And then what are you talking to them about?
Specific to the pandemic.
Yeah, pandemic or just in general. I mean, obviously the pandemic has made some pretty significant changes in the way we work. But do you think there's anything in the security landscape that's changed fundamentally because of it?
Yeah, so first of all, what you talked about in terms of integrated solutions, I totally agree. Our research indicates that 80% of companies would be willing to buy the majority of their security products from a single vendor. Now, that single vendor will have to work hard and have good solutions, good integration, but that market opportunity is there. And it's because of the complexity and the lack of integration in the past. Specific to COVID-19, let me bring up a slide. So we have recently done some research, and these are the types of challenges that we see. And I'm sure that it's very consistent with what you're seeing, Art. Let me just break this up into two. If you look at the top two challenges that people talked about, so one, making sure that all remote employees' computing devices have been securely configured, and then two, giving remote employees secure access to the corporate network. That was the scramble phase. So think back, just after we came back from RSA, there was a lockdown, and the security team had to work with the IT operations team in tandem to get people up and running from their homes. I'm sure you had to do that at Broadcom too. So it was a scramble. Who's got what device? Is it secured? Can we get them network connectivity? Do they need a VPN client? That's what you're seeing in those first two answers here. And that phase is done at this point. Now, it's not perfect, but for the most part, we've got people up and running. We've got them online. Now comes the harder part. The fine tuning of the infrastructure, the fine tuning of security. So you see things like monitoring traffic and behavior associated with remote employees. What are those employees doing? Are they doing things that appear to be insider threats? Is there something malicious happening that may indicate that their systems have been compromised? Do they have access to systems or privileges on systems that they shouldn't have? The only way I can do that or understand that is to collect, process, and analyze data. Coordinating moves, adds, and changes with the IT and the network ops team. Okay, there's a lot of moving parts here. People are using different devices. They're coming in from insecure networks. How do we monitor that? Well, we have to work. Well, once we monitor that and have to make changes, we have to work with the IT ops people. Now, that's always been the case, as you know. Security kind of finds the problem. IT ops fixes the problem. But there's a lot more problems. There's a lot more scale going on. So I think what's represented here is that transition from phase one to phase two, where we scrambled to get everybody access. Now we have to make them secure. Now we have to lock down our policies. Now we have to lock down our infrastructure, and we have to do that at scale. So that's a pretty significant change that we're seeing. And I'm wondering, is this consistent with what you're seeing? And if not, or please add to it as you see fit.
Yeah, no, I think one of the things that I believe has happened and that we're experiencing, obviously, with the pressure on our infrastructure, and we see it also, is this transition to work from home. I believe it's this grand experiment of the forcing function of sort of digital transformation, right? And so we've talked about digital transformation for decades, and companies have planned for it, but there's always been this kind of fear to jump into the unknown. And so people took baby steps, and some companies move faster and some move slower. But when you see like massive state governments moving completely to this work from home and trying to figure out how to get insurance and all of these other kinds of things working from state-run enterprises, I think what's happened is this digital transformation has accelerated probably a decade into the future, just because we were forced to do it. And so now you've got organizations, most all organizations were already in this kind of weird, what I would call cloud adolescent phase, where they have 1 foot on premise and 1 foot in the cloud. And, you know, they want to be all cloud, but they're actually still on premise. It's like my, you know, 14-year-olds. They want to be adults, but they're still kids. And so that that transition is absolutely happening. And so the security challenge that at least I have seen with for my customers is, how do you bridge your policy? Because you have the tools and you had a lot of infrastructure that was already established for your own environments. And now you've pushed more of your experience, more of your environment into SaaS and or cloud kinds of environments. You're connecting from home, in some cases on personal devices. And so it's accelerated that requirement for this sort of hybrid world and this hybrid environment. And whether that means we're going to move faster to a zero trust architecture or these, you know, some of these fancy marketing terms that we talk about for taking your policy and enforcing it in someone else's infrastructure, I see that as one of the sort of the lasting pieces of this, because I don't think companies are going to go back. I think, yes, we will go back to the office. Yes, I think there's room for collaboration and people want that interaction. And I think we'll find, but we're going to find a new equilibrium. It's not going to be all in the office. And I don't believe it'll be like Twitter and Facebook. Everybody works from home forever, because I think people will get lonely and they want to be together. And so we'll have this weird kind of hybrid that I think is going to, that's going to continue. And so that puts a ton of pressure on SaaS services. And so we've obviously about a third of our revenue was from SaaS services. And so we saw big growth in those spaces, not necessarily all without pain for us as we, you know, scramble to keep up with the capacity requirements. But that is, that's absolutely some of the things that I see, and that journey towards needing to put your policies in someone else's infrastructure, I think is a future. That absolutely is where people are trying to figure out. And the reality is there's a lot of marketing out there for being able to do that, but that technology is catching up to now the COVID reality of really needing to actually implement that in a much more effective way, so that the policies are consistent on premise or in the office, in your network infrastructure, and then now also in your SaaS infrastructure and your Amazon and Google and Azure infrastructure. So,
yeah. If I could sum up the change in one word, it would be scale.
Yeah.
Everything we've done has been put into hyperdrive, as you said, but that means more devices, more network traffic, more cloud workloads, more SaaS applications, more. And security teams aren't used to or very good at coping with more. So leaning on vendors, managed services, scalable solutions in the cloud, easily deployable solutions from the cloud, all that makes a lot of sense today. And I agree with you, moving forward, they're not going away. That's going to be a requirement.
Yeah, I mean, I think we see it in our own business. We look at, obviously, the massive push to work from home. Our developers are working from home. How do they connect securely? How do they do this? Well, they're coming from all different places. And so just the network infrastructure to be able to manage all that connection back into sensitive systems and the protections we need. And, you know, obviously, we're working with security code. And so there's just been a lot of new technology and monitoring that we've had to put in place just to make sure we can do this effectively. And so far, so good. I mean, our business has been as productive. You look at the pieces, and I'm not sure how sustainable it is long term. And I don't know if others on the audience feel similarly. But most of our employees are working at least an hour and 15 minutes longer, so they don't take that commute. And so they're working longer. And so, of course, they're more productive. How long that productivity is sustainable, we'll see. But it's, you know, it's obviously driven a lot of requirements for us on the security side to be able to do that.
Yeah, and we have research that I'm not going to show today, but that says that knowledge workers feel like they're more productive working from home. So that's a good, at least they're happy and they're productive. So that's a good trend, and I think you're reflecting that. And speaking of COVID-19, the pandemic, yeah, there's another word that comes to mind,
yeah,
and that is threat. So I'm seeing everyone's research, including from Broadcom Symantec, that says that the threat landscape, there's more volume, there's a lot of scamming going on, social engineering. And I always think of Symantec, I think one of the best kept secrets in the industry is how extensively you guys have always been in threat intelligence and threat research.
Right.
So do you have some things that you can tell us about what you're seeing?
We do. And so maybe I'm going to share a slide with the audience here from some of the research we've done. Let's see if I can do this effectively without crashing everything. There we go. And so I think what you're seeing here is some of the research that we have pulled together just as we go through. And it's been a huge, huge increase in attacks, and particularly around COVID. And so if you look at, the phishing campaigns, one in 20 essentially are COVID related. And so massive increase in that we see in sort of phishing attacks, also over the phone. And so a lot of attacks that have been coming over the mobile devices as they go after workers that are at home. I think the challenge that a lot of companies have faced is as you move into your home, you don't have the same infrastructural protections a lot of times that would have helped. And so we see, massive amounts of attacks on people's personal devices and or targeted at people's personal devices around it. Email obviously is a big delivery mechanism. And so, through the times in February, we saw, about 5,000 blocked emails a week. By March, it was, up to 82,000 different kinds of emails that are coming in the subject line. And so different unique things. Obviously this represents millions and millions and millions of emails, but uniqueness, 82,000 different ones. June in June, we saw, it spike even more. So you're looking at just week to week, you're seeing, 62,000, 70,000. And so we're in this sort of critical zone now of massive attacks of around this. And so obviously the best way to try to take care of this is to partner, right? And so we've been working a lot with the coalitions that are going after that. Our researchers are engaged in it. But no question, this any type of event globally. But the thing that's interesting if you're a security geek like me, interesting about it is how specific this is to the entire world. And so typically you see regional and or country level events that happen, and that creates a boost in spam and email. But this is obviously a global pandemic, and so the impact is global on this. And so that is that's a big part of what we see here. So I don't know if you've looked at and thought about sort of what could happen post pandemic, or thinking about sort of what the more permanent or longer lasting impacts to security are. But I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on, as we get through this, and we're all hopeful that it will end, and unfortunately nobody really knows when that's going to be. But I'd like to start thinking about the post-pandemic world. What do you think are going to be some of the more permanent or long-lasting impacts on cybersecurity? Like, what are people doing today? How are they responding? What do you think the sort of the permanency is going to be, if there is something that's going to be permanent, John?
Yeah, Art, I've been talking to CISOs. I've been doing research. I just posted a blog on CSO online specific to this topic. So let me share one more slide. And so this is a good kind of bellwether of what's going on. What you see here are the areas that security professionals say that they will invest in as a result of the pandemic. So you can see identity and access management, endpoint security, web and email security. But let me put that in the context of where I think things are going. So I think in this highly distributed world, it's gotten more distributed. We're finally at a point where we're going to do what security professionals have been trying to do for years, and that is move the controls to the end states. So identity and access management or device management with endpoint security, we need to secure the endpoint. And the endpoint includes the identity of the user. Now, on the other side of the pipe, there's data, there's sensitive data. So to me, those become the new perimeters, identity and the identity of a person and of a device. And then data on the other side become the new perimeters. Now, one of the things that I think really helps to support that is policy management. And you mentioned that. So we've been kind of, kludging our way through policy management for years. But now what we're seeing is that we really need very strong business policies that we can enforce and monitor at a granular level. And oh, by the way, we need to change those based on threats, based on changes in the infrastructure, changes in terms of new partnerships, M&A activity like Symantec and Broadcom, all of those things impacted. And I know this is a big ask of the industry, but I think we need some better way to not only create, but manage policies, enforce policies, and move forward with a really scalable granular policy management. Thus, you can tell, and these are areas that Symantec and Broadcom play in, that's why you need strong identity management at one end of the pipe and good data security at the other end of the pipe. And then one other thing I'll mention, and then please chime in with your thoughts, is you talked about threat intelligence. I'll go back to my word scale. We need threat analysis and research at scale. So that means consuming threat feeds. It means parsing through those. It means isolating those campaigns that may be applicable or targeted to an environment like yours. It also means understanding the controls that are in place and understanding whether you're vulnerable or not. And then the automation on the back end to say, if I'm vulnerable, let's start a process for remediation. So I've just said a mouthful. What are your thoughts?
There was a couple things that you said that resonated with me. One is this migration of policy or enforcement back to the endpoint. We talked a little bit earlier. I've been in the industry now for 20 years or so. And when I started, obviously, Symantec was a big player in the endpoint, still is a big player in the endpoint. And the policy was all in the endpoint. And then it became harder and more performance limiting to put all the policy at the endpoint. And so it moved to the network because that was, quote unquote, cheaper and easier to do. And so you see this sort of pendulum swing from endpoint being the power center to network being the power center. And now we're in this world where, encryption is coming and 5G is going to change massively the network infrastructure and the ability to enforce policy there. And so it's kind of swinging back. And so that was one of the things that you said that I think is absolutely true. I think in this world where we're mobile and we're connecting through home networks and infrastructure that's not our own, that it's even going to be more true in the world of zero trust. You're going to see more capabilities pushed down to the endpoint as we go forward. And I think that absolutely is not necessarily in response to COVID, but I think accelerated for sure by it. And that's one area that you mentioned that definitely resonates with me. And for obviously, self-serving reasons, endpoints are important to me, but also I think just infrastructurally in general, it is actually just a truism that will be true. I think the other thing that you said that I'm not sure how we solve because it's hard, but we are focused on trying to build a platform to enable it, is this idea of, you didn't use these words, but I'll use it, policy orchestration across products. And you talked about the joining of policy on-premise and cloud and then across product areas. And there's a lot of focus in the industry now around automating security response. But to do that effectively, you need to have some more common languages for how the products talk to each other. And there's a couple of questions in the chart around moving to standards and trying to think about how products communicate in standards. And so the way we are playing there, a way that we're working to try to play there, is to be as standards based as possible, even in the way we integrate our own technologies. And so with the ICD platform using, you know, REST APIs to and standards based APIs to do that, to the extent we can conform to the taxonomies that are standards based for threat understanding, threat intelligence, taxi, and some of those other kinds of threat intelligence standards. But then making our products orchestratable, I think, is a big part of sort of how we make this work more effectively. The challenge I have always seen in this policy orchestration, there's been a lot of products out there trying to be a policy orchestrator, and they've all died because it's just really hard. And so whether that will be something that the industry is able to solve in the future, or we are going to continue to rely on customers to manage the complexity of the different technologies, we'll see. But Symantec is definitely up for participating in that, and will conform to the policy standards that come, because I think it's an important part of being a platform. You see this happening in CRM, you see it happening in ERP systems. I think security is ripe for it, and that's a lot of the reason why we've invested in ICD as we've gone forward. But that's definitely, I think it's definitely something that we need to be thinking about as we go through there. So, it's a complicated time and a complicated space to work through. So I think that's the thing that our industry's got to figure out. So. When you think about the work to implement some of this zero trust security, and so we'll go off the sort of plan script a little bit here as we go. There's a lot of capabilities that I think are still nascent, and when you think about these capabilities, we hear a lot about AI, we hear a lot about ML, it's kind of the new marketing buzzword. What types of capabilities do you think are still nascent that that we should be and or other vendors should be investing in to try to really truly go to this world where you can enforce policy and other infrastructure? And obviously I have an opinion, but I'd love to hear your thoughts about how you think about securing infrastructure that you don't own, how you think about, you know, putting your policy into SaaS, how you think about sort of those kinds of challenges that I think our customers are facing.
I agree with you that standards are really important, but the security industry has been pretty, I'd say, lackadaisical in terms of cooperation on standards. And this is one of the reasons why I believe that organizations are willing to spend more with fewer vendors, is because they want that. And so if a vendor like Broadcom has ICDX and has open APIs and relationships with other vendors who can play in your architecture, what we call the SOPA architecture, then that works. So you need sort of a master builder, so kind of like your general contractor who would farm out all the different activities in building a house. I think we'll have that as well. Now, in terms of things like machine learning, I think we're going to get a big dose of investment and innovation based on COVID-19, because you and I, we can hire all the security people in the world and they won't be able to keep up with the pace of change.
Yeah.
And it's at scale. So we need the machines to do more thinking for us. And in the past, we've really focused that in the security industry, we focused that on threat detection, and we still will. But for instance, we need to focus that on the risk side. So is there new infrastructure in place? Or in your example, I've got a third-party partner now. Well, what is the risk on talking to them? Where are the, you know, what are the vulnerable systems, and can those vulnerable systems be exploited? So I think that's important. Then automation is very important too. So we've got the SOAR tools. That's a good start. We need more kind of just fundamental automation, just the easy stuff. Let's get rid of that. Let's automate everything we can, up to a point, and then let's make it easier for our analysts, our policy managers, our compliance managers, our risk management consultants and analysts. Let's make it easier for them to do their job, because a lot of it's still paper-based, who owns this IP address, that, all the stuff that you know about.
When I look at the investments that we have made in the technologies and in particular, you know, AI, and again, back to the sort of buzzwords today, I would say most of that investment historically in a lot of technologies, and I think the probably the most useful investments that have been made in those areas in the recent past have been around individual product effectiveness. So whether it's the AI and ML types of technologies and analysis that goes into making our endpoint product sort of identify threats that aren't signature-based, basically look at behaviors and learn, the way in which the email system rules get created essentially by machine, as the machine learns and sees it, it creates a smarter response. And I would say it's more machine learning than true intelligence. Like the machines aren't going to start to program and build themselves, but they do create rules, right? And so there is a machine learning, the algorithms get smarter, and it starts to really push itself. And there's been a lot of investment that we've made and will continue to make in the individual places, whether it's on endpoint or email, the web environments that we have. I think there's more investment that could go into DLP. In the information protection space, I think natural language translation, there's a lot of new innovation there. And I think that industry has been a little stagnant, Symantec included, in the way in which we deploy some of that technology into our information protection space. I think there's a lot of tech out there for doing this in identity, but most of it is not leveraged effectively yet. They do it in fraud, but they're not doing it yet as much in access management as I think they could. And that's going to be, I think that's the new horizon, the frontier there is, can you do this intelligently in access management? Can you be flexible enough in adaptive authentication? I think is probably the fancy way to say, you know, I'm at home connecting from a work computer, therefore I have these rights. I'm at home connecting from my personal computer, I have a different set of rights. And being able to be flexible in how you do that, I think, is going to be a critical capability that companies are going to have to figure out how to deploy and manage. And I think that one of the challenges they have with it is their infrastructure for authentication identity is candidly, it's old and stable and fragile, and so to do some of this stuff is going to be going to be hard work. And so I think, if I look at some of the places where investment is going to have to accelerate, I think these are some of the areas. And you talked about identity management in your slide as being one of the primary things that people are going to push investment into. And I think that's why that space in particular is super complicated to replace and change. It doesn't have all the capabilities it yet needs to really facilitate this, you know, adaptive way of interacting with information that you used to have sort of one standard way. And I think we're realizing that one standard way is not enough. So we're, I don't know, John, if you have any more comment there, and then otherwise I'll go to some of the questions that have come in off the internet, if that makes sense.
Yeah, we can do that. I was just going to echo your point. I mean, the identity management infrastructure is as old as dirt. We built it out of rack F in the mainframe world and just kind of layered out and out and out and needs massive change.
And I think to your point, the real challenge there is that infrastructure is in there. And in large companies, in smaller companies, you can make that transition really fast because you just re-architect and redo it all. And the reality is it's still disruptive, but it's not as complicated for a company of, you know, 500 employees to go through. It's just work, you do it. But when you're in a company of 10,000 or higher, that transition is significant because it's how your employees interact with everything or how your customers interact with everything. And so the fragility of these old systems and the ability to transition into new infrastructure is just really complicated. And, you know, when I worked at HP, and I think this is true at Symantec or was, and less so at Broadcom because of our mentality of, you know, fast moving and, you know, and we're not afraid to break stuff as we move forward. There were servers in the data center that were older than me. They just have Lucite sit around them because you don't want to touch them because who knows what'll happen. And the person that wrote the software has retired and has moved on. And so I think that is some of the reality of our customers' environments. And so you've got to live in that world on one end, and then you have the, you know, Kubernetes and container world on the other end, and that transition is an interesting challenge for everybody in the security space in particular, because of the diversity of things you have to protect. So folks, I'm going to go to the questions. I've been reading through them at a high level, and there's, I think, a couple of different categories. One of them has to do with just being frustrated with the transition Symantec has made to Broadcom, and so I want to honor the questions that you're asking and speak to it truthfully. And so I'm going to paraphrase them because I think there's a handful of the questions that are common. And in general, the basic paraphrase, and I'll just say it bluntly, is why has my support from Symantec Broadcom sucked so bad as we've gone through the transition? And so let's just talk about it bluntly. And I think the reality is we have, as we've made this transition, we have not lived up to the commitments we've made historically in delivering services to our customer base. And I'll give you the context, and it's not an excuse. It's just the reality of what is happening and has happened. And so I want to make sure that we're honoring your question and giving you real answers. Part of the challenge we have run through is temporary. And so I think part of it is, but not all of it. So part of it is temporary, and that is just a transition into new systems. Symantec was a patchwork of multiple systems and databases, and over time you build up enough memory and muscle to deal with that complexity. And we just had a lot of human resources thrown at sort of hiding that complexity. And so customers settled into a steady state with how they interacted with us. And we were able to get things done because we just had a lot of extra muscle making that work. In the transition, we obviously have migrated a lot of those systems to a single system. We've migrated a lot of the infrastructure. We've changed the teams. Some, in some cases, organized more effectively. In some cases, candidly, we just lost people that didn't want to make the transition. And so some of this, what I would call legacy knowledge that we had, has left the building. And so we're having to relearn. I think that part of the challenge for our customers, we will get through. And so whether it's being able to respond effectively to renewal licensing, being able to get your licenses posted, we prioritized where we spent that time. And you know, I know it's painful for some of our smaller customers. Doesn't mean the company is smaller, but they spend less with us. We prioritized our effort to try to make it as effective as we could for the customers that have invested the most with us first. We focused on the next sort of set of customers, and then the final long tail of very small customers. And so I think what we've been able to do is get the customers that represent about 70 to 80% of our revenue, we've gotten them to a stable part. I think the next 20% of revenue we're now cleaning up and is I think probably relatively stable, although there are some things in that area where we're still learning. And then the much longer tail of large amount of customers, numbers wise, but from a revenue perspective, 10% of our revenue we have dealt with last. And so I think that is the truth of where we are. And I believe that will clean up. Part of the thing that is true with Broadcom/Symantec now is we have one system, we have one way of doing things. And so all of our people will know how to execute well and deliver after we learn how to do it. And so I think we're getting through that process, and I'm hopeful in the next, you know, couple of months, maybe less, those parts of the interaction with us will improve and it will be better. That's the part that I think is temporary. The part that is more permanent is that Symantec Broadcom is more focused on what I would call segmenting the customer base and providing a level of service that is more representative of the investment that's made in Broadcom. And so if you've made large investments and are a strategic customer to us, we make large investments and are strategic and treat you strategically. If you are tactical and buy one product here or there, our response to that is we deliver the quote unquote contractually obligated support levels back. And in some cases, that transition from Symantec, where we kind of treated all customers in one standard, we were underserving, I think, our largest customers, and we were overserving our smaller customers. That transition is something we've gone through. And that's not going to be popular with everyone. And I want to acknowledge that and be transparent about it, because I think I do get a lot of escalations. I get LinkedIn notes, and I try to help to the extent we can, but there is definitely a transition in how we have thought about supporting the sort of vast majority. We had almost 200,000 customers, how we can afford to effectively service all of those customers. And I think the only way you do that is a little bit like the airline model. You have the super high frequent travelers, and you have the what I would call the infrequent vacation travelers, and they get a different service level experience when you come through. And I think that's something that definitely Broadcom is definitely implementing as we go through. And so just making sure that we answer that question very, very specifically. And I think that is that was one of the big pieces that I saw in some of the questions, and we'll go through. I think what I'll try to do also, there's another question around, where we're investing. And so I've held a couple of webinars, and I'm sorry, John, I'll try to kick some questions to you. I know some of these are obviously directly to Symantec, so I'll make sure we do that. And if the folks on the phone on the backside for Symantec could help me sort of go through some of these questions and feed it to us in the chat, that would be helpful. But where are we investing? What are the places that we're investing? So Broadcom and Symantec are focusing on what we think of as our primary franchises. And so I will highlight what those are. And I would expect, as a customer of Symantec going forward, that you're going to see us investing heavily in this. Broadcom as a company is about 70% of their employees are engineers building products. So myself and my teams that are focused on that, we spend a lot less everywhere else, and almost all of our resources go into product engineering, which means we spend over $5 billion a year on R&D. And so a large percentage, almost 20% as a percentage of revenue, goes back into the development and delivery of technology. And so while Broadcom is very profitable and focused on delivering that value back to shareholders through dividends and otherwise, we do invest a large percentage. If you compare us to other technology companies out there, a large percentage of our revenue goes back into product engineering and development. And so where is that for us? There are four categories of technologies we care a lot about. One is around the endpoint. And so we're going to be focusing in on that endpoint and the evolution of that endpoint. And so not only is that sort of the core technology that we have always been known for and the evolution of the threat landscape there, whether it's AI-based or otherwise, but also on the new evolution of endpoint into EDR and managed EDR and some of those pieces. And so I would expect to see us continue to invest heavily in that, and that migration into new platforms like mobile and sort of cloud-based endpoint servers and otherwise. That technology investment will be strong, and we'll continue to build there. It's a large percentage of our revenue, and we want to maintain that that position. Second is in what we call networking. And so that's our web and email space. There's been a lot of customer or sort of competitor FUD out there, and sort of the demise of our email and email domain in particular, but there's a lot of customer noise or competitor noise about how we're walking away from those, which is just patently false. We're continuing to invest there. I think the challenges we've had some in our stability, at least in those systems in the short term, part of that has been the massive scale growth that we've seen and just catching up, chasing the rabbit a little bit there. And the other part is we migrated the infrastructure from the old Norton data centers into GCP. And so massive amounts of architectural change that's happened over the last 6 months. But the reality is we have migrated the web service completely now into GCP, and we're quote unquote done with that. And we've moved about half of the infrastructure of our email infrastructure, the entire control plane and everything into Broadcom infrastructure now. And so, but we're continuing to invest heavily in those areas in terms of effectiveness and the market lead, and not just in what I would call the base technology, but also the evolution to new environments like isolation and some of these new domains, which will become the proxy of the future, whether that's a combination of web isolation and CASB and some of these other technologies, which we know for sure will be the next generation of the web infrastructure, along with break proxies. That's number two investment. So endpoint, this web and email, DLP. We've been the market leader in DLP for the last two decades, partly because we have the superior architecture. We support with one single information policy all of the different places where your data could go, which was different than all of our competitors. And so we won that space, quote unquote, won that space very fast. And we've continued to invest there, and we'll continue to invest there. In fact, we're doubling down in that. We've already acquired a new company, Bay Dynamics, about 2 months in. And so Broadcom is investing and continue to drive the leadership in that space, even through acquisition and in addition to our portfolio in DLP. And then the last area is identity. And so we have a very well-established and stable identity business. Obviously, the combination of our VIP two-factor authentication with the privilege access management and the authentication management of SiteMinder and CA technologies, bringing those together. And with the four of those things, we have, I believe, all the capabilities we need to do zero trust. Excuse me. And so we're one of the only vendors that can deliver that from our own portfolio without having to integrate. And so a true sort of endpoint network information policy, as well as identity, we have all the capabilities we need. And so investments in making sure we can deliver that to you. And so that is a I guess not a short answer, but a complete answer of at least the areas of investment. And we've had some webinars that you can go back to in the Bright Talk history where we talk about each of those components in more detail. And so I have my product leaders and a facilitated product discussion where we were able to share a lot of that information with you. And so if you're more interested in that, that would be great. Let me ask Jon a question. I know we've got about 5 minutes left, and we've got some things going through here. And there's been a couple of questions on the remote workforce. And so I know I made you sit there, Jon, as I rambled on about the Symantec stuff, but I wanted to make sure I honored the questions that were coming in directly. But you know, how should, when you think about reorganizing as an organization around the new reality that the developers and general users or these folks are working from home, how should they think about changing the way they do their work? And you know, how should organizations adjust? And I know we've talked some about this, but if there's some things that you would recommend to companies as they adjust to this, where you know they're not only their employees but also their customers are kind of working from home, how should they adjust to that?
So one of the things we're seeing, Art, is companies doing a lot of assessment of their business processes. So understanding where the intersections are, where the collaboration takes place, at what part of the process, and then just making sure that those things are running smoothly. Now, what I can tell you is the companies that have done really well in this transition were the ones who'd already done strong implementation of cloud, who'd already really invested in collaboration tools and the kinds of things we're doing now with Zoom and WebEx and those kinds of.
We're all becoming expert in these new technologies. I know I switch between like all of them during the day as I talk to different customers.
We are, and we know them all now. So it's, I'm not sure I'm answering your question correctly, but it's really understanding, again, it's the processes and understanding where organizations really need that face-to-face cooperation. Now, what we're seeing in security, for example, is that priorities have changed, and some projects that are more that need the kind of in face-to-face planning or kind of twiddling the knobs are being deferred. So that gives you a sense of what we're seeing out there. It is really, though, for the new reality of people working from home, we do have to understand their jobs, the processes, who they work with. And then one other thing I'll say is we have to pay attention to the people. So, and I'm sure you're doing this as the leader of a company, but are people burning out on Zoom? I know I am. I'm sure you are.
I'm definitely sick of it.
But, you know, the mental health aspects of working alone. So as it becomes safer, so where I'm in Massachusetts, we're now at phase 3 of reopening. We have the lowest transmission rate in the country right now after, you know, 100,000 cases. So now we're talking about, well, maybe we can get together in social distance, but at least get together. So it's really paying attention to the dynamics and the mental health of your workforce.
Yeah, it's interesting. So Broadcom has started to come back into the office also. And so we started with, you know, as California and the rest of the country and also our global offices started to allow us to work from the office, we started in shifts. And so we have currently 4 shifts of 25%. And so part of, I think, that process is to get used to the protocols. And so the protocols are, you know, you show up and there's a station, you sanitize your hands, you get a mask, you come in through the front door, the security guard is there and they do a temperature check of you. And then you go to your desk and your shifts are designed based on where your desks are essentially. And so you have, you know, 30%, you know, 25% of the office. And so you're literally 12 to 15 feet apart all day long if you come in for your shift. I think the best we will get is 50% before any kind of vaccine or anything like that comes out, because I think you'll still need to maintain that social distance. And so you have to rethink the way you do your office. And so there is an element of rethinking the office space and where you sit. But part of that is to bring employees back together again and try to drive some collaboration. So maybe it's mental health. Some of it is collaboration. It's those pieces. And I think a lot of our customers are going through that. And a lot of the industry, obviously, is trying to figure out what is safe, because you want to be safe, but you also want to balance the need for interaction and the collaboration and effectiveness of the business, because this could be going on for quite some time. And so trying to figure out how to manage that, again, sustainable productivity, not the I'm just working more because I'm at home and, you know, what else am I going to do because I can't go outside, but the sustainable productivity that I think we're all kind of craving for as we go off into the future. So,
yeah, people are social animals. And so some people are extroverted. They'll want to be there. Some people are introverted. They may be fine from home. We've got geographic issues, regulatory issues, cultural issues. So there's a lot to uncover there.
Yeah. So folks, thank you very much. I know that there are some questions that we haven't answered in the chat string. We'll look forward to trying to answer those either directly with you or in other venues as we go forward. If we'll try to get back to and answer the questions that you've asked us. I hope that you feel we've answered as many as we could through the process, as well as stayed on target for what we promised this webinar discussion would be. Thank you a lot for joining us. Before you sign off, if you wouldn't, please take a moment to rate the webinar and this format. I'd love to hear what you think about the discussion format, as well as the way in which we're bringing some information about Symantec, as well as hopefully useful information about what other companies and organizations are doing to deal with this. Obviously, if you're interested in learning more about our endpoint, we have another webinar coming up this Thursday where we're going to talk in a lot more detail around the roadmap and where we're going. We'd invite you to join us there for a more deep dive in an individual product category where you can ask specific questions around the roadmap. And there's a link to sign up for that in the attachment page of the Bright Talk platform. Again, thank you so much for joining us today, and thank you for your investment in Symantec and our partnership going forward. Jon, thank you very much for joining me. It was a real pleasure to chat with you as always, and I look forward to the next time we get to get together, and at some point, hopefully have a drink again.
Yeah, good to see you, Art.
Take care, everyone. Bye-bye.